Hello, welcome to my spooky themed book reads this week. So I read 6 books this week. I think it's everything that I said I was going to read on my previous list. But yeah, well, apologies already. I am very sleep deprived and have a lot of brain fog, but I'm going to do my best to talk about the books. So I'm going to start with the ones that I did not finish. That was These Witches Don't Burn by Isabel Sterling. So partly this is my fault, didn't realize it was a teenage one set in high school already. I was like, nope, it's going to be too young for me. And then there was a scene where the main character, who is a lesbian, identifies as a lesbian, is asked out by her male friend. She completely loses her shit at him. It's like, how dare you? You know I'm a lesbian. He apologizes profusely and says, I was told by this girl that you're actually bi, and I just think you're amazing, and I generally like you as a person. I thought I'd ask you out. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. And then she just goes like scorched earth on him, and then she goes to seek her vengeance on this girl that has told everybody she's actually bi, not lesbian, to sort of hurt her. And at that point, I was like, no, not for me. I don't know about everybody else, but I've had instances in my life where I've been asked out by someone I am not sexually attracted to. I have had people incorrectly assume my sexual orientation, and in none of those situations, like, I have to preface though that this boy, her friend who asked her out, did it in a very respectful way. So he was very respectful to her. So in no situation where I was respectfully asked out or had my sexual identity incorrectly assumed did I lose my shit at these people. I thought, no, I can't read if this is what the main character is like. I don't like her, and I don't want to read any more of this book. It is too juvenile for me, and that's why I DNF'd it. Then I also DNF'd Witch Unleashed, Untamed, Unapologetic by Lisa Lister. A witch is a wise woman, a healer, yet for so long the word witch has had negative connotations. In this book, third generation hereditary witch Lisa Lister explains the history behind witchcraft, why identifying as a healer in past centuries led women to be burned at the stake, and why the witch is reawakening in women around the world today. Okay, this was not what I thought it was going to be. I read half of this book hoping it would get better. It did not. I could not stand the tone or the voice of the author. It was very rah, rah, pussy power, inspirational Instagram style wording, all like show and no substance. I don't even think they talked about anything real. Like, there was a lot of self-congratulatory almostness about her own, you know, the fact that she's actually hereditary, which has been passed down through her bloodlines. And, you know, there was just a lot of it made me feel a bit ick, and I didn't vibe with it. And there wasn't representation of, say, different ethnicities. And also it was very centered on, like, you have to have a pussy to be, you know, sort of a powerful woman, witch, whatever. And I just, yeah, there was a lot of it that I just did not like. And I would not recommend it at all for people who want to learn about witchcraft, for people who want to learn about feminism. No, it's not for any of those things. So that I DNF'd after reading half of it. Next, we've got A Dowry of Blood by S.T. Gibson. Saved from the brink of death by a mysterious stranger, Constanta is transformed from a medieval peasant into a bride fit for an undying king. But when Dracula draws a cunning aristocrat and a starving artist into his web of passion and deceit, Constanta realizes her beloved is capable of terrible things. Finding comfort in the arms of her rival consorts, she begins to travel, unravel their husband's dark secrets. With the lives of everyone she loves on the line, Constanta will have to choose between her own freedom and her love for her husband. But bonds forged by blood can only be broken by death. So this book has been doing the rounds. I'm sure you've heard of it by now. It's about Dracula and his brides. In this case, though, there is a male in his harem, so it's not just female brides. It's told by his first bride, Constanta, whom he named, so he renamed her. And I'm actually very surprised that she doesn't rename herself after this. She doesn't take back, like, her own name, even though she refuses to name Dracula in her letters. She says, I'm taking your name away from you. But it's sort of told in a, like, an open letter style, like she's writing to her sort of deceased husband. So there's not a lot of scenes with him actually in it. It's mostly her sort of, like, viewpoint of what happened and the slow sort of realization of the abuse. It's sort of more like covert abuse, where it's more about like control and emotional, psychological sort of, you know, abuse, and how all of her sort of emotional reactions, and it's a lot about the relationships too between her and him, and her and his other consorts that he adds to their family. And it was well written, easy to read, interesting. I enjoyed it. There are obviously trigger warnings in this sort of book, but I didn't find it too heavy and dark, to be honest, or too gruesome. But I really enjoyed it. So it was refreshing retake of, you know, Dracula's story. And then we've got The X-Hex by Erin Sterling. 9 years ago, Vivian Jones nursed her broken heart like any young witch would. Vodka, weepy music, bubble baths, and a curse on the horrible boyfriend. Sure, Vivi knows she shouldn't use her magic this way, but only an orchid hayride-scented candle on hand, she wasn't worried it would cause him anything more than a bad hair day or two. That is, until Reese Penhallow, descendant of the town's ancestors, breaker of hearts, and annoyingly just as gorgeous as he always was, returns to Grays Glen, Georgia. What should be a quick trip to recharge the town's ley lines and make an appearance turns disastrously wrong, and she finds out her silly little ex-hex was not so harmless after all. Okay, so I knew going into this it was going to be more of a fluffy, fun, you know, not so serious story. It was okay. And the reason, I think I gave it 3 stars. The reason it was just okay is mostly because I felt absolutely no chemistry between Vivi and Reese. Like, nothing. And when a book is basically, it is more of it's a romance book. When you don't buy the romance, what else is there? Like, there's a bit of atmosphere with, you know, the town being autumn and that, all that sort of vibe. But in the plot, I guess, you know, figuring out how to undo the curse. But it didn't deliver for me. It was fine, but it just wasn't great. So that was The X-Hex. DNF, this one is a few DNFs. Small Town Big Magic by Hazel Beck. Witches aren't real, right? No one has civic pride quite like Emerson Wilde. As a local indie bookstore owner and youngest ever Chamber of Commerce president, she'd do anything for her hometown of St. Cyprian, Missouri. After all, Midwest is best. She may be descended from a witch who was hanged in 1692 during the Salem Witch Trials. But there's no sorcery in doing your best for the town you love, or is there? Oh my God. Oh, why didn't I read the blurb? So this was an audiobook. Didn't read the blurb, just saw witch and was like, put it on there so I can listen to it. It was awful. I DNF'd it so fast. The main character, I couldn't stand her. She was arrogant, so arrogant and insufferable. You can even hear it in the blurb. I hated the way she talked about people she loved. I hated the way she talked about people she didn't like. She was just so conceited, and I just could not stand. I think I only listened to like 20 pages. I thought, no, can't do it. If this is a main character and everything's in her voice, I cannot listen to a single second more of this. So that was a big hell no for me. Ordinary Monsters. I haven't written the author here, but I'm sure it's in the picture. If not, I'll type it up. England, 1882. In Victorian London, two children with mysterious powers are hunted by a figure of darkness, a man made of smoke. 16-year-old Charlie Over, despite a lifetime of brutality, doesn't have a scar on him. His body heals itself, whether he wants it to or not. Marlowe, a foundling from a whale ray freight car, shines with a strange bluish light. He can melt or mend flesh, and when two grizzled detectives are recruited to escort them north to safety, they're forced to confront the nature of difference and belonging and the shadowy edges of the monstrous. So this had major Umbrella Academy vibes to me. Huge vibes of that. All of these orphan children have like mysterious powers, and they're all being like brought to this place. I think it's called Candale, can't quite recall, but this like school for, you know, special kids. They're not really told like what their purpose is really. It's sort of like, is the school the good or the bad guys, or is this other shadow man that's like hunting them the good or the bad guy? It's sort of that whole ambiguous, who's good, who's evil, who do they believe, what do they do? It was well written. It was very atmospheric. It was a lot of great characters and character building. I would say the pace is a bit slow for me personally, but I was invested. I did want to find out what the heck is going on and what's the like end game of this and who's who and all of that jazz. It was quite dark. There's a lot of death, a lot of killing. So if you don't like that, don't read this. I just like this sort of the grey morality-ness of it, like who is a monster and who is it, what makes a monster, and all of that. And even though this book does centre around the children, they are young children, there are adults in this book as well. So that's the thing. Like, I can't read about teens unless it's not just about teens. It's not from the perspective of a teen only. It's got some adults in it, and this does. So I enjoyed it. Am I going to continue reading with the series though? I am not sure. I don't know if I want to continue reading. It's sort of like, it could be just a single book in and of itself. I'm sort of like satisfied where it's sort of left, even though it definitely does lead on. Like, you can feel like, okay, I need to find out what happens to this character and what's going on here. But I could also just as happily just leave it there and not be like wondering what happens. So I don't know. I might read it. I might not. But I'm not dying to get the next one, if that makes sense. Belladonna by Adeline Grace. This was fantastic. I devoured this in one go. I was so into it. I love the writing. I like the world building. I like the characters. I wanted to find out what the heck was going on. I really wanted to unravel the mystery. Let me tell you what it's about. So there's this girl who is sort of unable. She's touched by death, but she's unable to die. And yet wherever she goes, so she gets passed from family member to family member, and all these family members end up passing away. So she's just constantly getting new guardians. And then she finally ends up at an estate with some estranged family members. And the mother, who's one of her relatives, died under mysterious circumstances. And her daughter, which is her cousin, is also dying under mysterious circumstances. And she sort of developed this relationship with death in the meantime, because he's unable to sort of reap her. And so they actually communicate. There's a bit of romance in it. It was just delightful. I don't want to give it away. I liked the romance that was in it. I liked the progression of the story. I didn't guess who was behind the mysterious deaths. I will admit that. This wasn't what I was thinking. I think it's meant to continue on. So it's meant to be like a series. And I'm interested to read more. I just really enjoyed her as a main character. I'm so happy she was in her 20s and not a teenager. It's so refreshing. But it was definitely a fantastic book, and I was thrilled with it. The cover also, I think, is really, really gorgeous. So those were the books that I read this week. Some were amazing, some were truly awful, absolutely horrible, but that's the way it is. I'm going to let you know what I'm reading next. So here we've got The Hemlock Cure by Joanne Byrne. Let me open up. So it is 1665, and the women of Iam keep many secrets. Isabel Frith, the village midwife, walks a dangerous line with her herbs and remedies. There are men in the village who speak of witchcraft, and Isabel has a past to hide. So she tells nobody about her fears about Wulfric, the pious, reclusive apothecary. May, Wulfric's youngest daughter, dreads her father's rage if he discovers what she keeps from him, like her feelings for Rafe, Isabel's ward, or that she studies from Wulfric's forbidden books at night. But others have secrets too, secrets darker than they ever could have imagined. So this was one I was hoping to read this week, since it's got the witchy, magic-y vibe. So my bookmark's all over the place. It's so cute though. It's got dandelion. I'll take it out so you can see. It's something different. It's metallic, and it's got like flowers engraved on it. And it's got a little glass ball filled with dandelion seeds, which I thought was darling. So got that for myself. So I'm excited to read that. On the front it says, some poisons cannot be bottled and some secrets cannot be contained. And then we've got, I'll show you the bookmarks. I got this for free. Keep Your Head in the Clouds. It's beautiful up there. And on the back it says, Dandelion Seeds of Fairy Kisses in Disguise. And it's by Paola Merrill. And she's got a little store. I'll link it down below. I bought some of her artwork and she gave that for free. So that was very sweet. Reasons to Go Outside. This Summer Life is Changing One Step at a Time by Esme King. Pearl Winter hasn't been outside in 43 years, and since she arrived on Dartmoor as a girl, an isolated family cottage has been her whole world, a place of safety. But now 59-year-old Pearl is utterly alone except for the postman, the crows, and her memories of the summer of 1976. Sad to read that. I've always had a bit of issue with sort of agoraphobia, I guess. Not so much that I'm scared of going outside, I really don't like it. I'm very hermetic. I'm happy to just stay in my home all the time, like besides maybe going to the park or something like that. I don't really like being around people that much. I don't know if anyone's the same. I just find it very overwhelming and it's very stressful to socialize or just to, like I said, to be around a lot of people's energy and to associate. It was so hard for me as a librarian. And I think it did contribute to a lot of my health problems. It was just too much. And that's the main reason why I am no longer a librarian and I work from home instead. My nervous system could not take it. I thought that was good to read because I have to also like force myself to go outside, even though I love nature. I just feel very safe and happy in my little cave. So I hope that wherever you are, you're having a happy Halloween. And as always, stay wild, Star Child.